words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be to the greater honor and glory of God.
Amen.
So I must confess a sin to you this morning that I had a very busy week and I did not have time to prepare a sermon this morning. But Jesus says in the gospel that you have to forgive me. So forgive me.
We do forgive you.
No, just kidding. If you walked into a Christian house in the late 1970s, maybe early 1980s, you would probably see hanging on a wall somewhere in the house a poem known as Footprints in the Sand. Yep. And some of them were just framed, and some of them were like wooden plaques that were, you know, enameled and all kinds of things. So here's the way this goes. One night I dreamed a dream as I was walking along the beach with my Lord. Across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one to my Lord. After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that many times along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and saddest times, there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why. Why, when I needed you most, you would leave me? The Lord whispered, "My precious child, I love you and will never leave you. Never ever during your trials and testings. When you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I was carrying you." That kind of reminded me of... I talk a lot about things that are kitschy, that you see that on a wall in a house, and you think, especially in this day and age. But if you really read it, I mean, the way it's presented sometimes can be kitschy, but when you read it and you think about it, it has a deep theology to it. And it reminds me very much of the story of Exodus this morning. We've been following through Moses from when he was in the burning bush and arguing with God, and then going in the plagues and the Passover. And then, after the Passover, when the firstborn of the Egyptians are all killed, Pharaoh finally gives in and lets the Egyptians go free. And so they go off and they end up at the shores of the Red Sea. And Pharaoh's heart is hardened, so he wants them back. And he not only wants them back, he would like to destroy them once and for all. So there's this, the Egyptians, they have all these many gods. And the Israelites, they have one God that they believe in. They believe in Yahweh, the God of the ancestors of the Israelites, of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he had said to Moses, when Moses asked for his name, "Who am I?" "I am who I am." So there's this battle of the gods that has taken place. And Yahweh wins the first battle when Pharaoh finally lets them go. But today is this second battle that they find themselves, Israelites have maybe made a mistake, where they have found themselves up against the shores of the Red Sea, and Pharaoh's army then comes in behind them. But this is where God really stands out, and this is where the Israelites really remember God, or should have remembered God, that they had the Egyptians, had them all hemmed in. But God put put a wall, an angel of God, put a wall of protection, a wall of fire that didn't allow the Egyptians to come and destroy them. But yet, they were still hemmed in. And they were crying out for help. And God said to Moses, you know, raise your staff. And so he raises it and parts the Red Sea. And that is when they truly get to freedom. There's no going back at that point. Because when they were there on the beach, you know, they were like, why did you bring us out? Many times they say to Moses, why did you bring us out here to die when we could have just as easily died back in Egypt? So God wins round two. Yahweh wins round two as well. Yahweh provides this wall of protection and an avenue of escape. And I think that that has a lot to do with the footprints in the sand too, that in that time of trouble, God comes through in a big way. We don't sometimes notice that it happens. We don't, just like you don't, you notice the missing footprints, but you don't see or feel God carrying you through this. This has to do with discipleship as well for us. That discipleship involves us being that angel of the Lord to somebody in need who feels trapped. You know, they've got enemies all around them and a sea of trouble in front of them. They're surrounded by it. But we as Christians were called to be obedient to Christ and to Jesus and to follow him. And also to provide this wall of protection around those in need and an avenue of escape for others. As I was also thinking about this, I was thinking of Dunkirk. That in the end of May of 1940 into early June, the German army in their blitzkrieg had invaded Belgium and then France and had pushed the French army and the British army into two pockets, a smaller one at the port of Calais and the bigger one at Dunkirk. Over 300,000 French and British were there. But Hitler, I don't know whether it was God's intervention or what, but Hitler decided not to destroy them. He was going to let his Luftwaffe, his Air Force, just bomb into oblivion. But the British tried to send over big ships to rescue these. But what the thing about a big ship is, it's an easy target for a dive bomber. And so they were just losing big ship after big ship. And there was just seemed no way to rescue. So what they did was they sent a call out to everybody who had a boat, the recreational sailboats and fishing boats and anything that could get across that channel. And they had hundreds, if not thousands, of British sailors and recreational sailors and so on cross this channel. And they managed to rescue over 338,000 British and French soldiers. And so that reminds me a lot that they were hemmed in by the German army. That's a lot like ministry in and of itself. That if we try to do things in a big way, sometimes those things fail. But each one of us, in our own way, is like that little boatman or that little fisherman, that we have the opportunity. We can't in and of ourselves save a whole army. But each and every one of us can save one person. We can get one person off of that beach of despair. And we can be that person like the footprints of the sand and like the Lord that picks that person up and carries them to safety. So, how has God in your life been that when you have felt like you have been on that beach Exodus, or maybe like in Dunkirk, where you have had all kinds of trouble behind you and trouble in front of you, and it seems like there's just absolutely no way out. But God has, or has either picked you up and carried you out of that, or God has sent somebody to do that and help you get through that. But, as I said, we are also equipped to do that, or we're supposed to be equipped to do that. That we are to take our little boat of God and send it out.